Right now on Discovery Channel, find out the real story behind the Cuban Missile Crisis. It's DEFCON 2.
October 1962. The United States Strategic Air Command moved the American military to Defense Condition 2, one step away from nuclear war.
Each one of those bombers had a target.
In both the U.S. and Moscow, there were accusations and denials.
I'm prepared to wait for my answer until hell freezes over.
American invasion forces prepared for a massive attack by sea, air, and on land, with nuclear weapons placed in the hands of captains and majors.
If called upon to use a weapon, we would have fulfilled our orders.
We're going to throw the Soviets out of there and, you know, teach them this is our hemisphere. And we're going to do away with Castro once and for all.
The attention of the world was on the island nation of Cuba, where men, women, and children were mobilized to defend against an imminent invasion. In the White House and the Kremlin, there was a lack of sleep and communication.
The question that was raised, who's in charge in the Soviet Union? You know, that's when things really get dangerous.
The fate of the world was at stake. There could be little doubt that if war came about, it would be nuclear.
There was panic. There's no two ways about it. People thought that this was a real thing.
I told my wife, I will not go to work today. I don't know what will be tomorrow. It's quite possible that tomorrow we will not be alive.
DEFCON 2, the highest state of American military readiness, short of nuclear war. It was the height of the Cold War, and the leader of the Soviet Union, Premier Nikita Khrushchev, was contemplating his next critical move. He took a walk with his defense minister, Marshal Malinovsky, on the shores of the Black Sea.
When the days are clear, you can see across the Black Sea the lines of the Turkish shore. And Malinovsky and Khrushchev, walking alongside, were discussing, and then suddenly Malinovsky said, "Well, Nikita, look there. It's Turkey. There are American missiles." And Khrushchev reacted, "We must think about it and do something."
But Khrushchev could see more than Jupiter missiles in Turkey. He could see the Soviet Union's weak strategic position, and he didn't like what he saw. He saw America and its NATO allies surrounding him with nuclear weapons, 15 Jupiter missiles being installed in Turkey, 30 more in Italy, and 60 Thor missiles in Britain. But most threatening of all were nearly 1,600 American strategic bombers and 200 intercontinental ballistic missiles, which could strike the Soviet Union from the US. In the Cold War balance, the Soviets were at a significant disadvantage. General Anatoly Grybkov served on the Red Army General Staff in Moscow.
America,
the United States had about 5,000 warheads, the Soviet Union 300, and of those, only two or three dozen that could hit the United States. Unfortunately for Khrushchev, the Soviet Union was surrounded by military bases, American bases. But America was free of that encirclement.
However, there was a glimmer of hope for Khrushchev. Fidel Castro's Cuba, a communist island in a sea of American power. It was his one small foothold in the Western Hemisphere. But Cuba was an ally that could be lost at any moment. America had been trying to overthrow Castro since 1961, first by small infiltrations, then by an invasion by Cuban exiles trained, armed, and sponsored by the CIA. The mission at the Bay of Pigs failed terribly.
The Bay of Pigs invasion of 1961
1960 was the culmination of activities of the United States against the Cuban Revolution.
After Bay of Pigs invasion and its collapse, Moscow got a proof that there are real intervention plans supported, at least supported, by Washington.
Khrushchev's solution was to do with Cuba what the U.S. had done in Turkey, put nuclear weapons right under the enemy's nose. With one bold stroke, Castro's Cuba would be protected from impending invasion, while Khrushchev's bargaining power and his prestige would be enhanced. The Soviet strategic position would improve practically overnight. At the Ministry of Defense in Moscow, General Grybkov took a lead role in planning the top secret operation.
Sure.
There were no telephone conversations, no letters written, not even calls, nothing.
The operation was codenamed Anadir, the name of a cold Siberian city, a deliberate diversion from their planned tropical destination.
And it was decided to send a mission to Cuba to discuss this idea with Cubans.
Fidel didn't give us an immediate answer. He said, we need time to think.
Cuba felt that when this offer was presented by the Soviets in May 1962 to deploy these missiles, we felt obliged to accept them in order to show solidarity towards socialist countries that were supporting Cuba in this very unequal battle against the U.S. administration.
On the third day, Fidel said, if it is necessary for the interests of the world revolution and the interests of the Soviet Union, then we agree.
With Castro's consent, Operation Anadir moved forward. It would be the largest seaborne operation in Soviet history. But the Soviets had just 4 months to organize and transport 60 nuclear missiles to an island almost 13,000 kilometers away, along with 40,000 men. And it all had to be done in secret. It was the height of the Cold War, and the leader of the Soviet Union, Nikita Khrushchev, secretly planned with Fidel Castro to store Russia's nuclear arsenal in Cuba. At Soviet ports, 85 cargo ships were prepared for departure. Together, they would transport 60 ballistic missiles, jet aircraft, and more than 40,000 men to an unknown destination. Even the ship captains had no idea where they were heading.
Before we sailed, we were given 3 sealed packets numbered 1, 2, and 3. On the first was written, to be opened after leaving the territorial waters of the Soviet Union.
As the ships passed through the Bosporus Straits in Turkey, the second envelope was opened. It contained the order to sail beyond the Straits of Gibraltar and into the Atlantic Ocean.
In the third packet was the order to go on to Havana, Cuba, and everything became clear.
Clear, but not easy. Temperatures below decks reached 110 to 115 degrees.
The situation was very difficult. There was not enough water. There were no bathrooms. We had to use buckets. But the worst part was the heat. We were almost dying from the heat and the stuffiness, but it was forbidden for us to go out on deck. There was a guard. They only opened the hatch at night, so men could go out on deck and get fresh air.
As the ships approached Caribbean waters, they were closely watched by American aircraft. The Americans had good reason to be vigilant. Throughout 1961 and 62, the United States military had been developing plans for a full-scale invasion of Cuba. Its code name was Oplan 316. Flying as low as 60 meters, the American Navy planes photographed the ship's mysterious cargo.
When we were 2 or 3 days from Cuba, we noticed the American reconnaissance aircraft above us. On the last day of our trip, an American helicopter was hovering above us, almost touching our mast.
The photographs from the Navy patrols were rushed to Washington, D.C. An elite team of photo analysts at the secretive National Photographic Interpretation Center, or NPIC, studied them. Dino Brugioni was a lead analyst on the team.
During 1962, there was just one ship after another carrying supplies to Cuba, and we were looking at each one of them. When the Russian freighters came out of the Bosphorus, they were photographed in the Bosphorus. They were photographed again from our units in Sicily and Gibraltar. So we had all this photography coming in.
The photographs showed crates on the decks of the ships. While Brugioni and his colleagues couldn't see the ship's cargo itself, they knew that what they saw was suspicious.
We had a good knowledge of the crates that the Soviets packed their aircraft in because we had been watching Egypt and Syria and others who were receiving Soviet aid. We could precisely measure the crate. In a sense, we would make like a little box and then see what would fit in them.
As the Soviet ships unloaded their cargo at the port of Mariel in Cuba, U.S. surveillance photographs confirmed the contents of the crates: fighter jets, patrol boats, and trucks. But there was no photographic evidence of any nuclear missiles. For the time being, the Soviet secret was safe. Leading one team of missile engineers was a young major, Burnov.
We would unload at Mariel only at night. We had the missiles in a big hangar, and we would only transport them after 3 in the morning.
Moving at night kept the missiles secret from the watchful eyes of the American surveillance teams. Keeping the operation secret from Cuban civilians, however, proved a greater challenge.
It was difficult to maneuver a 30-meter-long missile on a truck. It's hard to corner in small villages where there may be a 90-degree turn with a telephone pole. So we would have to cut down the pole to get through.
The Soviet soldiers wore civilian clothing and were not allowed to speak Russian. Once troops arrived at the designated sites, the living conditions remained difficult.
We didn't have housing. We had to build it ourselves. We didn't want to go to bed. We were scared of insects biting us.
Meanwhile, 23,000 meters above them, they were being watched. The American U-2s were high-altitude spy planes carrying cameras loaded with high-resolution film. They shot huge negatives of the ground from 22 kilometers in the air. The U-2 could see fine details, including small vehicles, men, and even tire tracks. But August 1962 was a cloudy month. For 3 weeks, the U-2 flights were put on hold. The assembly and concealment of the Soviet missile sites continued unobserved. By the end of August, a U-2 spy plane was finally cleared for a flight over Cuba. When the film was analyzed by the NPIC, the Americans discovered the first signs of real trouble.
On an August 28th mission over Cuba, we spot these objects. This particular pattern looks like a Star of David.
The photo analysts recognized the pattern from previous reconnaissance photographs of Soviet weapon sites. There was no doubt the objects were SAMs, SA-2 surface-to-air missile sites. The Americans had two problems. The SA-2 SAMs were capable of shooting down a U-2 aircraft, and the fact that the Soviets had installed sophisticated anti-aircraft weapons indicated that they were protecting something much larger. But for the time being, the nuclear missiles were too well hidden to be seen.
The missiles were covered in tents. They were 30 meters long, put into a ditch and covered so that from above, You could only see tents.
As Major Richard Heiser returned from a six-hour flight over Cuba, he landed his U-2 spy plane at McCoy Air Force Base in Orlando, Florida. The film was rushed to the Offutt Air Force Base in Nebraska and then to the National Photographic Interpretation Center in Washington for analysis. Airman Michael Davis was a 23-year-old photo analyst stationed at Offutt.
I walked into BB-12, which is where we briefed all the generals all the time. Major Olson was in there. He says, "There's your table." He says, "And here's the film. Let's get started." About 1 o'clock in the morning. And I said, "Where's the circle?" So we pulled down the screen, and then the SAM circle appeared. I said, "Let's look in the center. We got something."
After hours of scrutinizing, Davis came across a series of long cylindrical shapes that looked strangely familiar. At the NPIC in Washington later that morning, Dino Brugioni and his staff noticed the same irregularities.
We're seeing eight objects 65 feet long. We're seeing two objects that are 100 feet long. And these are alien to that environment.
The conclusions of Brugioni and Davis had grave implications. The measurements of the objects matched the Soviet SS-4 medium-range ballistic missiles perfectly. And the missiles were known to have nuclear warheads.
And we were convinced that this was what we had was a field-deployed SS-4 site.
The Soviet SS-4 missile had a range of 3,200 kilometers. If launched from San Cristobal, Cuba, it could hit Washington, D.C., Baltimore, the Strategic Air Command headquarters in Nebraska, and the entire southeastern United States. NPIC Chief Art Lundahl went to the White House to brief President Kennedy and his National Security Council on the discovery. The meeting, like many others during the crisis, was secretly recorded by President Kennedy and only recently declassified. In the room with President Kennedy were Marshall Carter of the CIA, Defense Secretary Robert McNamara, Attorney General Robert Kennedy, National Security Advisor McGeorge Bundy, and other top aides. The group became known as the Executive Committee of the National Security Council, or XCOM.
This is a result of the photography taken somewhere, sir. There's a medium-range ballistic missile launch site. Two new military encampments on the southern edge of the Sierra del Rosario, west central Cuba.
Who would that be?
West central, sir. The launch site of one of the encampments contains a total of at least 14 canvas-covered missile trailers measuring 67 feet in length.
How do you know this is a medium-range ballistic missile?
The Soviets had made a bold move. The discussion turned towards a quick solution. Defense Secretary McNamara proposed airstrikes to destroy the ballistic missile sites before they became operational.
I think it's extremely important that our talk, our discussion, be founded on this premise. Any airstrike will be planned to take place prior to the time they become operational, because if they become operational before the airstrike, I do not believe we can state we can knock them out before they can be launched. And if they're launched, there is almost certain to be chaos in part of the East Coast or the area in a radius of 600 to 1,000 miles from Cuba.
What no one in Washington knew was that at least one ballistic missile site in Cuba was about to become operational.
But by the time President Kennedy received that report, at that moment our missiles were already in place, and we were ready.
In Washington, President Kennedy mulled over his military options.
How long did it take to get an additional invasion?
No, sir. It's a matter of 7 days after the airstrike, assuming the airstrike starts the first of next week.
You get six divisions or seven divisions in Cuba in 7 days?
There are two planes we have. One is to go at maximum speed, which is the one referred to you by Secretary McNamara, about 7 days after the strike. We put in 90,000 men in 11 days. If you give us more time so we get all the advanced preparation and pre-positioning, we put the same 90,000 in the back.
A naval blockade of Cuba to keep out further Soviet weapons was another option. But the military wanted an invasion. Kennedy needed time to decide and ordered an increase in U-2 surveillance flights. What no one in EXCOM realized was that the Soviets in Cuba were also armed with battlefield nuclear weapons and short-range missiles that had the ability to decimate an invading army. American troops would face the weapons if they launched a land attack on Cuban beaches. Also unknown was the threat of a nuclear strike from the sea. Steaming towards the Caribbean at high speed were four heavily armed Soviet submarines. Nikolai Shumkov was captain of one of them.
Our submarine was armed with 22 torpedoes, one of which was a nuclear torpedo.
Three American Navy aircraft carriers patrolled the Caribbean, unaware of the approaching submarine threat.
As far as I'm concerned, having received an order to use my nuclear torpedo, I would surely have aimed it at an aircraft carrier, and there were plenty of them there in the area.
But the greatest nuclear threat to the United States was about to be discovered. At NPIC in Washington, Dino Brugioni's team analyzed the latest film from a U-2 spy plane.
The missions had been flown on the 16th and 17th, and we find these, which were referred to as slash marks. And we immediately recognized that these were IRBMs, intermediate range ballistic missiles capable of being fired from Cuba and going 2,200 miles. I had taken a map and I'd scribed an arc, and it would cover all of the United States except the extreme northwest.
At EXCOM, it quickly became apparent that the Soviet response to a U.S. invasion of Cuba could mean the destruction of nearly the entire United States continent. The next day, President Kennedy met with Soviet Foreign Minister Andrei Gromyko to discuss the nature of arms shipments to Cuba. Gromyko denied that there were any offensive weapons in Cuba. Kennedy could prove otherwise, but resisted the temptation to confront Gromyko with the photographic evidence. If he decided to take military action against the missile sites or invade the island, he would need the element of surprise. On the morning of October the 19th, 1962, President Kennedy met with the Joint Chiefs of Staff. The senior U.S. military commanders favored airstrikes followed by an invasion, but Kennedy disagreed. He thought that the Soviets would retaliate in a different theater by taking West Berlin, ousting the Allies. With the Joint Chiefs angry, the Soviets in denial, and the possible invasion of Berlin heavy on his mind, the President kept up appearances by going on a political trip to the American Midwest. The following day, unbeknown to the Americans, the first missile site in Cuba was now operational and could launch on 5 hours' notice.
One regiment was made combat ready on the 20th. Because of equipment delays, our regiment was not ready until the 25th.
In the Caribbean, the tension in the Soviet submarines was fed by an eerie radio silence.
Radio communication stopped. There was complete radio silence. There was no radio communication whatsoever, and that seemed odd to us. We guessed that there was an abnormal situation, but we didn't know what it was.
Shumkov was not in contact with his commanders, but the U.S. Navy was in touch with Shumkov.
We were being hunted by an anti-submarine aircraft. The carrier Essex was blocking us. Its mission was not to let us pass through the defenses. It was a problem without a solution.
Aware that Soviet munitions were being transported to Cuba, EXCOM met to decide what to do next. They decided to create a blockade, but since blockade had overtones of the infamous 1948 Soviet blockade of Berlin, Secretary of State Dean Rusk coined the term quarantine. Plans for airstrikes followed by an invasion of Cuba continued to be drawn up. Attorney General Robert Kennedy called the president and suggested he return from his political trip to Chicago to listen to the XCOM proposals. Claiming he had a cold, President Kennedy returned home. Op Plan 316, the invasion plan of Cuba, had been underway for 10 months, but now it had a new immediacy. The timetable was for Marines to land in Cuba just 8 days after air attacks started. Op Plan 316 would involve 500,000 men, including 40,000 Marines, almost 15,000 paratroopers, 1,000 aircraft, and 180 ships. Elements of the 1st Marine Division left Camp Pendleton in California for a voyage through the Panama Canal and into the Caribbean. Tom Brooks was a naval intelligence officer with the task force.
Leaving San Diego was one of great enthusiasm, anxious to go get them. We're going to throw the Soviets out of there and, you know, teach them this is our hemisphere, and we're going to do away with Castro once and for all.
As President Kennedy returned to the White House, he had no idea how many Soviet soldiers were in Cuba, or that his troops may be heading towards a nuclear battlefield. On the same day, the CIA noticed that at least one of the Soviet ballistic missile regiments in Cuba was ready to fire at any time. Kennedy had wanted any airstrikes to happen before the missiles were ready to fire, but the window of opportunity had now closed. The invasion called for landings on the northeast and northwest coasts of Cuba, plus a breakout of Marines from Guantanamo Bay to attack what was thought to be 8,000 Soviet soldiers fighting alongside the Cuban army. But the Soviet troops waiting for them in Cuba were far more numerous than the Americans had estimated.
There was a great reluctance to believe that there were organized combat units in Cuba, and a reluctance to believe that they would actually engage U.S. forces.
Also, Op Plan 316 didn't realize there were any Soviet tactical nuclear weapons.
I hesitate to think even what that would have led to. We were not prepared at all for, you know, nuclear combat.
October the 22nd, U.S. Navy ships were ordered to enforce a blockade of Cuba, setting the stage for a showdown with the Soviet convoy. Defense Secretary Robert McNamara ordered U.S. families and their dependents to be evacuated from Guantanamo Bay and dispatched Marines to reinforce the base. In Havana, Fidel Castro was also preparing for the worst.
At noon on the 22nd, it was announced that Kennedy would be addressing the nation that night, and we knew as soon as we heard that it would concern Cuba, because they've discovered the missiles. At 3:50 p.m., the armed forces were put on alert. At 5:45, the combat alarm sounded, which means the men were in the trenches with weapons in their hands.
The United States military was on high alert, and the world braced itself for Kennedy's speech. At 7 p.m. on October the 22nd, President Kennedy addressed the American public.
Good evening, my fellow citizens. This government, as promised, has maintained the closest surveillance of the Soviet military buildup on the island of Cuba. Within the past week, unmistakable evidence has established the fact that a series of offensive missile sites is now in preparation on that imprisoned island. The purpose of these bases can be none other than to provide a nuclear strike capability against the Western Hemisphere. It shall be the policy of this nation to regard any nuclear missile launched from Cuba against any nation in the Western Hemisphere as an attack by the Soviet Union on the United States, requiring a full retaliatory response upon the Soviet Union.
Kennedy's speech echoed throughout the world. The seriousness of the crisis was now exposed. The U.S. Strategic Air Command placed the armed forces on a higher defense condition. DEFCON 3.
When Kennedy announced that the missiles were deployed in Cuba, it was a very serious situation, and war was something that could happen at any moment.
We heard President Kennedy on the radio telling the American people that we were on the verge of thermonuclear war. About 10 divisions were gathering in Florida for the invasion of Cuba. We received orders from headquarters for a four-hour readiness for the use of our nuclear-tipped torpedo.
U-2 photographs had convinced the experts in Washington that there were Soviet missiles in Cuba. But to make a conclusive case to the rest of the world, detailed close-up photographs were needed. The responsibility for capturing the images would fall on Navy Commander William Ecker of Light Photographic Squadron C-2.
After I took off, there was a strong west wind, and I was flying just a compass course, and I happened to, about after 10 or 11 minutes, I looked up, and there at 11 o'clock was the Havana skyline, and I thought, oh boy, they're gonna know we're coming. So I just turned a little more to the right, headed out to Mariel, and then turned south for about 2 minutes, and I looked down, and there they were.
On the 22nd, they were flying at altitudes as low as 100 meters over. You could even see the pilot in his helmet.
I saw the missiles, and they were covered with a camouflage netting, but I could see that they had missile launchers and so forth down there, or trailers, and all kinds of equipment. So in there, 1, 2, 3 seconds, and depart.
Although risky, Ecker's high-speed mission was a success, and the photographs he took left no doubt what was there.
We see the missile ready, Tim. We see 5 missiles. We see fueling and checkout vehicles. And even if you look close, you can see men walking around. Now, this photograph is taken at 250 feet, about the speed of sound. And this is the kind of thing, now, when we're showing this to policymakers, this is what they really understand.
With Soviet denial still fresh, UN Ambassador Adlai Stevenson arrived in New York for a Security Council session, armed with a surprise. Leading the meeting was Soviet Ambassador Zorin.
Do you, Ambassador Zorin, deny that the USSR has placed and is placing medium and intermediate range missiles and sites in Cuba? Yes or no?
You will have your answer in due course.
I'm prepared to wait for my answer until hell freezes over, if that's your decision. Not content with the...
But Stevenson didn't wait. Instead, he launched into a presentation that would stun the world, and especially William Ecker.
He reached behind him, there was an easel there, and he flipped the shroud on it off, and there were the pictures, right at the UN.
At the cost of revealing secret surveillance capabilities, Ecker's photographs made the U.S. case undeniable. With American ships in place, two Soviet ships, the Yuri Gagarin and Kimovsk, steamed towards the blockade line. One of the Soviet submarines was carrying a nuclear torpedo. In the White House, Defense Secretary McNamara informed the president of the situation.
There is a submarine very close, we believe, to each of them. The submarine will be at the barrier tonight, late today, and hence it's a very dangerous situation. The Navy recognizes this, is fully prepared to meet it.
The war might have started this way. The American ships attacked the Soviet submarine and somehow harmed it. In that case, the commander would definitely have to use his weapons.
But President Kennedy was reluctant to start the war.
Get the service or take some action, to which the first ship will just go attack him anyway. At what point are we going to attack him? If we ought to wait on that today, we don't want to have the first thing we attack is the Soviet submarine.
It was almost a fatal tragedy for us. During the scat and mouse play with the Americans, we almost completely spent our battery. My engineer said to me, our battery is almost dead. We can't remain underwater. We can either surface or sink. I decided to surface. It was daylight. When I came up, I saw strange ships, American ships.
Later, Robert Kennedy would say that this was the moment that brought the world closest to nuclear war. And it was the moment that U.S. Strategic Air Command moved to a higher defense condition, DEFCON 2. Nearly 60 Strategic Air Command aircraft loaded with nuclear weapons were airborne around the clock. Bombers on the ground were loaded with nuclear weapons, given targets, and placed on a 15-minute alert.
I thought if there was a war, an invasion of Cuba, there would be nuclear war, and that would result in the disappearance of millions and millions of people.
On October the 26th, word reached the White House that inbound Soviet ships had stopped.
Now, what did they say they're doing with those, John?
Well, they either stopped them or reversed direction.
I suddenly received a message from headquarters ordering me to leave my position and retreat about 100 miles and take a stationary position.
The Soviets, it seemed, were hesitating. For the time being, at least, the first shots of war would not take place at sea. But on land and in the air, the threat of nuclear war was greater than it had ever been. In the event of war, the Strategic Air Command had but one nuclear scenario. Total nuclear commitment. Known as the Single Integrated Operational Plan, or SIOP, it planned to order every American nuclear missile, aircraft, and submarine to launch against not only the Soviet Union, but the entire communist world. While launch authority rested only with Premier Khrushchev and President Kennedy, many types of nuclear weapons on both sides could be released without authority. And the detonation of a single nuclear weapon could quickly escalate into global nuclear devastation.
So it was extremely dangerous situation. We were at a stage when that could have happened without the direct will of Khrushchev and Kennedy. It could happen as a result of nervous breakdown of rank and file people.
The blockade may have stopped the incoming Soviet ships, but 134 nuclear warheads were already on Cuban soil. All three of the SS-4 missile regiments were operational. Engineers like Voronov received orders from Moscow to increase launch readiness to just 2.5 hours. The nuclear warheads for the missiles were brought closer to the launch sites.
Our storage area for nuclear warheads was 50-60 kilometers away from us, so the actual combat readiness could be achieved in no less time than 5.5 hours in all. The readiness was 2 hours and 30 minutes once everything was in place there.
The Soviets didn't try to prevent flights by U-2 spy planes. However, the Cuban forces were becoming more agitated by the continuous violation of their airspace.
Have an anti-aircraft battery in place. The idea is to use them. But really, there was no decision on the part of the Soviets to start shooting against the U-2. Now, remember that the Soviets were the ones who were manning the SAM-2, the anti-aircraft missiles.
In defiance of Soviet complacency, Cuban anti-aircraft guns fired on U.S. reconnaissance planes. With the crisis escalating, new hope of a diplomatic solution came from an unlikely source. ABC reporter John Scarley met with a Soviet diplomat known as Alexander Fomin at the Occidental Restaurant in Washington, D.C., close to the White House. Fomin's real name is Alexander Feklisov.
My position as a counselor was that of a cover, because I was an intelligence officer, and moreover, I was the resident of the Russian intelligence group in Washington at that time.
Scully had talked with State Department officials and had been briefed on how to handle the conversation.
Coffee was served, and without any overtures, he said, on the authority of the highest American authority, I am proposing these terms of the Cuban crisis solution. First, the Soviet Union takes its missiles from Cuba and the U.S. removes its blockade. Second, the president gives a public pledge of non-aggression against Cuba. I said, there's a question, what do you mean by highest authority of the United States? And he said it letter by letter.
John Fitzgerald Kennedy, President of the United States.
In Moscow, Khrushchev composed a personal and emotional letter to Kennedy, appealing for an end to the crisis. He offered to remove the missiles in return for Kennedy's promise to end the quarantine and not invade Cuba. When the letter was finally received, decoded and translated, it was after 9 p.m. on the 26th of October. At 9 a.m. on the 27th, 12 hours later, EXCOM reconvened in the White House. While members discussed the conciliatory Khrushchev letter, President Kennedy was handed a news bulletin and read it aloud.
Premier Khrushchev told President Kennedy yesterday to withdraw offensive effort from Cuba if the United States withdrew its rockets from Turkey.
He did.
It's read by both the associations. Put it out for Reuters and the same thing.
He did.
He didn't really say that, did he?
No.
He may not be today putting out another
paper.
EXCOM believed that Khrushchev, or another new hardline element in Moscow, was adding further demands. The removal of U.S. Jupiter missiles from Turkey.
You know, to get those two different messages in close proximity, the question that was raised in the minds of not only myself, but a lot of other people, who's in charge in the Soviet Union? You know, and that's when things really get dangerous. You know, if there is some uncertainty about who's in command and who's giving the orders on the other side, that's when you know you're really in danger.
The 27th of October, 1962. As the Cuban missile crisis deepened, further photographic evidence of Soviet movements were needed. Ever since the Soviet missiles were first discovered, the U.S. Air Force had been flying regular spy missions over Cuba. So far, the Soviets had hesitated to fire at the aircraft. Then, at 9 a.m., Major Rudolf Anderson took off from McCoy Air Force Base in Orlando, Florida, for his flight over Cuba. At 10 a.m. local time, he guided his U-2 over the Cuban port of Baines. Against standing orders from Moscow, the Soviet commander on the ground decided to fire. The missile streaked 23,000 meters into the sky and exploded next to Anderson's aircraft, killing him and sending the U-2 spinning to Earth. The Cuban missile crisis had claimed its first combat fatality. Word of the shooting down didn't reach the president until a 4 p.m. meeting with EXCOM. A U.S. pilot had been killed, and now the military wanted revenge. Airstrikes preceding the invasion of Cuba were due to start the following day, unless Kennedy and Khrushchev could find a diplomatic way out. In Washington, the president decided to send Bobby Kennedy to meet with the Soviet ambassador, Anatoly Dobrynin, and make an offer. The Soviets would dismantle and immediately remove their missiles from Cuba, and in return, the U.S. would end the quarantine and promise not to invade the island. But the Kennedys secretly offered one more very substantial incentive. The U.S. would also remove NATO Jupiter missiles from Turkey, but only if the concession was kept completely secret by the Soviets. Kennedy gave the Soviets 24 hours to respond. With U.S. attacks on Cuba just hours away, the nuclear battlefield was as close as it had ever been. For For those in the know, both in Washington and Moscow, fear reached fever pitch.
I told my wife, I will not go to work today. I don't know what will be tomorrow. It's quite possible that tomorrow we will not be alive. Let's go to the cinema to see a new film.
The Secret Service wanted to take the president to the underground. Well, I had been to the underground and I was cleared for it. That night was one of the most miserable that I've ever spent because I kept thinking of what could happen and, you know, that I would be in a safe place and my family would be incinerated because I was convinced that Washington would be a target.
The whole of mankind was on the brink, on the verge of a nuclear abyss. We were 2 hours away from the end. 2 hours.
October the 28th, 3 a.m. in Moscow. The Soviets had an announcement to make. A personal message from Khrushchev to President Kennedy. This time, they used Radio Moscow rather than a Western Union telegram. Khrushchev announced that the missile sites would be dismantled and returned to the Soviet Union. President Kennedy held off military action for one day while he waited for new reconnaissance photographs to be examined.
The planes are out, and when we look at the photography, now they're pulling back. You could see that they'd pulled the missiles back, they'd pulled the launchers out. It was obvious now that they had gotten the word.
Over the following months, 60 ballistic missiles and 134 nuclear warheads were dismantled and shipped back to the Soviet Union. Serious tensions remained, but one of the most perilous chapters of the 20th century was over.